Our topic is seismic tomography. And seismic tomography is one of the leading edge technology now taking place. Seismic tomography means is composed of two terms. The first term is tomo, which means sections or sectioning. Graphy means imaging. So our terminology tomography means imaging by sectioning. This means that we estimate the perturbation of velocities at selected sections in space. The complete picture is an interpolation scheme, grading and interpolation between the sections. So we are cutting the subsurface into sections. If you remember last time when we discussed the 3D seismic data, seismic reflection, at the end slide we used or we saw time section. This or time slice. Here we have we'll have depth slice. In this slice, we'll have representation of the velocities, and these velocities is interpolated or graded between sections to produce the full image of the subsurface we are looking for. Tomography is not used only for seismic, but in many application, many geophysical applications, you will find resistivity tomography, find electromagnetic tomography, find all means of tomography. You will find also something called Croswell tomography, and this is used for environmental and also for hydrocarbon to monitor a change between the change of certain parameters, certain physical parameters between wells. Here we can see some examples to show the use of tomography. Here we have big projects taking place at Iceland and in Northwest Europe, or between Europe and the North America. We have Iceland and also Greenland. Both are subject to huge earth science and multidisciplinary science to study this area. Here, this is the geographic distribution of Iceland. And here we have, we can see the route of Iceland. the continental masses is proven or discovered that, sorry, it has roots. Roots in its lower boundary, and these roots are extending into the upper mantle, and these roots may serve for stabilizing also these rock masses like continents and so on. So through tomography, we can obtain this regional feature, which is the route for Iceland. Here, of course, this is the use of tomography for medical, it's called CT scan. And I told you before, for CT scan, we are sectioning, we are transmitting sound, say sound or electromagnetic waves from one direction and the recording from the other direction at certain levels. And then we combine this level to understand or to to define the places or the organs that have some problems or disease. It's also mainly used for cancers and some other cases. Here, this one is used for the nervous system, and also liver and so on. Well, it's not our specialization here. This one represent cross well tomography. Here in cross well tomography, the transmitter is here, and we record in other wells, and also we put transmitter here and record in other wells, and the same for the third one. And then the data is collected and interpreted and modeled to produce such detailed change in the Earth's material. This could be electric resistivity, could be seismic velocity, could be anything that we can measure or model. So what is the concept? Seismic tomography is generally a nonlinear problem. For solution, we have, for solution problem solving, we have two types of problems. One called linear, and the other is called nonlinear. The linear one, it's not line, but it's that we can estimate the model parameters, and the model parameters is not function of each other. So the model parameters are separate, and we can use like regression analysis to fit the data into the model. Okay? This is called linear modeling. An example of this is the equation of the form. Y equal A plus B X. Here the model parameters are A and B, and both are not dependent on each other. So we can fit the data. Usually the data are Y and X bare. You applied regression before, and least squares, you have any idea about least squares? Yes? Okay, so this type of problems, I'm sorry, because it seems most of the whiteboard markers are empty. Okay, but you can, you send this? But you can, in my blend space lessons, you will find some illustration about this. Okay, so here, Y, take something, Y1, Y2, until Yn, and X1, X2, until Xn. These pairs when drawn, it will take this shape. So the model parameter or estimating A and B will yield a straight line, minimizing the error, where here is A, okay, this part is A, and B is the slope of the line. Okay? So this type of problems is called linear, where A and B are not dependent, are not function of each other. But in case of seismic tomography, the problem is non-linear. I cannot apply the ordinary regression method. Why? Because there is interrelation between the parameters. Because we have the lens, the velocity. The lenses depend on the velocity distribution. And both are parameters, and both parameters are interrelated. Why? You will discover by the end. I will return to this point after we discuss the point of defining the estimated travel time. Okay, but for now you understand that our problem is nonlinear, so that it cannot be solved using ordinary methods or linear method like least squares or so. And that, we are going to use nonlinear or iterative method. In iterative method, we are conducting the computations many times in each iteration, or in each time, we are more and more approaching to the solution. That's what's called iteration. An example of iteration is the bisection method. I'm not sure you studied numerical methods or not, but I will give you a swift illustration. To understand what is iteration. So in bisection method, we assume that function f of x defined in the interval from A and B. The solution to the function f of x means root finding. Okay, to find the root for the function f of x. Now I have here A and B, the bound of the function, and the root, which is the value at which f of x equals 0, is somewhere between A and B. Theoretically, you can put this point, for example, here. Now we assume that A will be the value of the function will be negative compared to the root, and for B it will be positive compared to the root. Suppose the f of x is something like that. Okay? So the value of the function itself at A will be negative, and at B it will be positive. Okay? But we don't know this point. This point is what we need. We can apply, say, grid search from A and B to try to find this point and find the one where we have minimum. But this will take much time. The bisection method, for example, may dividing A and B into two halves, and then look for the value of the function f of x here. So here positive and here is negative. If the value of f of x here is positive, so positive and positive, there can be no zero here. So most probably the root will be in this half. So we'll exclude this half. So this is the first iteration. Then we work in this range. We will half this range and estimate f of x. If it's negative, and here we have positive, then we'll exclude this and the root will be here. And so on, we'll continue in our iteration till we arrive near to the value of the root. This is somehow illustration of the iteration. Iterations mean we are following certain scheme to approach the solution. The solution that we cannot obtain through normal or linear iteration. Okay? Clear? Clear, Sharawi? Okay. Here, the problem, in the problem, the subsurface is subdivided into blocks, like this figure. So here, sorry. Here the subsurface, as you see, this is the blocks. And these blocks is distributed all over the subsurface. The velocity is assumed to be homogeneous or constant within each block. So this is the assumption here. So our intention is to estimate, suppose this is the source and here is the receiver, to estimate the path from here to there, sorry. Colors here representing velocities. So within each block, we estimate the length and we subdivide the length by the velocity to get the times for this path, and this is the estimated time. Okay? This estimated time is then compared or used for measuring or arriving to the best fit model, as we are going to see. We have two types of seismic tomography. We have travel time tomography, and this one is simpler and widely applicable. The other one is the whole wave field tomography, which means we are dealing not only with travel time, but also we are interested in amplitude. And this type of tomography is very difficult, and the computational cost is very high. So we are mostly, we are going to, for simplicity only, to focus on travel time tomography. So what are the steps we are using for travel time tomography? We generally have these six steps. The first one starts by data preparation, time picking. We are picking the times from the seismic section, picking the travel time of the reflectors of all energy we need to model from the seismic section. The second point is to building the a priori model, the starting model. The third step is discretizing the subsurface, either as voxels or as nodes. Fourth, we are going to apply checkerboard test to test the validate the discretization scheme and model. And then we are going for model estimation, And finally, we are validating or verifying our estimated model. A priori model, this model is a starting model. Usually in any nonlinear algorithm, we have to feed the computer, feed the algorithm with a starting value. Start the velocity distribution and the subsurface. This model or velocity distribution model in the subsurface is built or using all available geophysical and geological data. The a priori model is usually 1D model for simplicity. We can simply, 1D model means the velocity the change with depth only. That's what's meant by 1D model. The final tomographic model is generally the deviation or perturbation in velocity, either horizontally or vertically. So, 1D model is a starting model, and the final model is to try to find the deviation for each node or voxel from this initial velocity model. This perturbation can occur horizontally or laterally or vertically. For our data or for our assignment, interval velocity model can be regarded as a priori model. For nonlinear algorithm, there are many arguments that we can start by any type or any distribution of velocity as a starting model, as a priori model. And that the model or the algorithm will produce the preferred model or the best fit model at the end, regardless of the a priori model. Meaning that I can just sit back and both model, both thicknesses and velocities, and input such data into the computer, and then the algorithm will give me the solution at the end. However, we have two important arguments. The first one, the computational time will be much larger, as we are going to start from maybe unrealistic or model that does not represent the area under investigation. And the second argument is that for certain algorithms, sometimes if I'm using model, initial model, away from the true 1D representation of velocity, I may end up with unstable model or erroneous investigation. So usually we can use 1D model that is estimated for the area, say interval velocity model, and then we apply this model for the tomographic algorithm. Do you have any comments? Any comments? Because I feel like the topic is not interesting as it should be. Because it should be interesting, despite the fact it's very difficult to carry out. So you, now you can figure yourself as a doctor, medical doctor, and the earth is the patient. And now you are going to make a CT scan for this patient to cure it, or accurately saying, to exploit it. Because as we go to doctors, they exploit us. I'm not offending doctors, but it's okay for joking. So do you have any comments before? Yes, Azim. Again, please, Asim.
And the velocity is assumed to be homogeneous within the block.
Yes, yes.
So the block is the color.
Yes.
The color block. So what does the line represent then?
The line?
Yeah.
This is the ray, the energy or the seismic waves, for example, used to move from the source to receiver, to the receiver. So it wasn't clear for you, because I guess the same question may be for all of us. Here we have number of sources, and we also have number of receivers. And these rays representing the traveling of waves from source to receiver. And for each block, in order to solve the problem and get good estimate, we should have many rays crossing it. So this part is very highly represented in computation, whereas these parts are not, and these parts are not, because no rays cross it, and this also. This part are not good estimated. It actually in the algorithm it will be ignored. We'll have no data at this part. But for travel time tomography, we have picked the time. This time is called observed travel time. And then from this rays, we estimate time, so we have the so-called estimated travel time. So we have observed and we have estimated. If the distribution, this is distribution, is perfect, so we expect that the estimated travel time to be equal to the observed or peak travel time, okay? Because it's perfect. This is the actual distribution. This is assumption. This is the actual distribution of velocity in the subsurface. However, the true or the real this situation is that we have difference between the model and the true model, the estimated model and true model. So we will have also difference between the estimated time and observed time. Okay? So the algorithm will make changes to the velocity of the voxels to adapt it to produce minimum difference between the estimated and observed travel time. This is the concept. Okay? Okay, Ashraf. You have any question, any comment? You seem very concentrating. Okay.
So after the algorithm is applied, then the color will change again?
Of course.
Okay. Until the minimum difference between the observed and...
Yes. Yes. Okay, so you can ask me, not ask her.
Mainly the graph is about velocity versus step.
Velocity
versus
step. Time or versus what?
The graph mainly talks about the velocity and the depth of the.
This graph?
Yes. Because
this graph is assumed to be just for illustration, but now it becomes the focus of the lecture. See, this is the space. This is x direction, and this is y direction. So this is the space. Say. One or say 100 meters. So we have this block, 100 meter times 100 meters located at this location. So this is the area under investigation. Okay, so each block represent the velocity values at this location, at the location of these blocks. Okay? Here, what is written here is slowness. Okay? Slowness is the inverse of velocity. Because we want to simplify relations, the mathematical derivation, here p is called the ray parameter, is a function of sine theta, the takeoff angle, divided by v. One. Okay? So in order to simplify the further mathematical derivation, we just use S, which is the slowness, equal 1 over V1. And then P will be S times sine theta. So the slowness here is the inverse of velocity, and it's used most often in imaging of the Earth's surface. Why? For simplicity, dealing with the numerator rather than dealing with the velocity in the denominator. So if you want to find what's the meaning of this dark blue, it's 1 divided by 0.75, which is about 1.3 kilometer per second. Okay, so this diagram show the distribution of velocity with distance or with locations. Okay. Now we are at the discretizing the subsurface, because we want to deal with the subsurface not as single unit, but as small units, assuming at each unit the value, the velocity is homogeneous or constant, so that we can find solution to the problem. So the subsurface can be discretized as either voxels or nodes. Voxels are cubes or parallelogram with length, width, and thickness. So the figure we spent some time with is only 2D, but in actually it should be 3D. So we have distribution, aerial and aerial plane, and also vertical. The velocity is assumed homogeneous within each voxel, which means it's constant for each voxel. Nodes, on the other hand, are points distributed regularly or irregularly. So sometimes for some locations we have much data than others. So for locations or sites with high data, we will have high density of nodes. Some others will have fewer energy than the previous one, so we'll have less number of nodes throughout the model volume. For each node, we assign value for the velocity. The velocity between nodes is obtained using interpolation algorithm, like contouring. You know, of course, contouring. So I'm now speaking about hand contouring. Did you make contour with your hand, or just use surfer or something by hand? So if you have point, say, with 500 and another point with 600, and you want to pass line of 550, so you interpolate between 500 and 600, maybe in the midway, and you pass the contour line, right? This is the same location. So when the ray pass between two nodes, and we want to find the velocity, we will compare the nodes around this point and define the value at this point. Okay, now we have a question that summarizes what we have said. What is the source of velocity we use to assign values for either voxels or nodes? So now we divided the subsurface as distribution of voxels and nodes, and for each voxel we assign velocity. What is the source of these velocities for vibration? No. These values of velocity, what is the source? Where do we get this values from? Yes? Bob up your volume? During acquisition? Oh my God. What? Somebody said something here? It means that you were totally asleep. Nobody? When we were small, the master will beat us with Okay. So what is the use of a priori model? A priori model. What is the use of a priori model? A priori model. No, okay. So what is a priori model? Distribution of velocity with depths, right? So we use the velocities from the a priori model to assign the values here at the first step. And then as operation, as iteration is taking place, these values change until we arrive to best effect or minimization, minimum error. So we are not concentrating. So this is where we use the a priori model to assign velocities to either voxels or to the nodes to start the operation. Okay? What question? A priori model. The source is the a priori model.
So the primer there, we use our own logarithmic engine. We use our own formula to try make our own model.
We use our own formula. Which formula you mean? Now you say, suppose in the assignment, now you end up with interval velocity model. Something like that. Here is the velocity. And this axis is depth. Okay? You use this one, this one is interval velocity, for example. You use this to suppose the voxel is lie here in this, in the first layer. This is the place of the voxel vertically. So suppose also this is 800 meter per second. So this voxel will be assigned 800 meter per second. Okay? If it's here, and suppose this one is at 1000 or 1200, it will be assigned 1200 and so on. Okay? So, what do you mean by different model?
As you mentioned, all the models are one, but it will assign different velocity from the radial to the model.
Okay, Oi. Now, to obtain the interval velocity, we used root mean square velocity and made many correction until we obtain the interval velocity. So this one should be, according to our work, good assumption or good start for the velocity at this area. Okay? Suppose you don't have the opportunity to make interval velocity, or suppose you have well data, check shots, you have sonic logs and so on. So you can use this data to build your a priori model. So you can use all available source to build good a priori model. The a priori model can be 1D model and also can be a 3D model based on our data we have. Okay, so each block from the figure you have seen, each block we define its place belongs to what velocity zone, and then assign the velocity to this voxel or this block. Is it okay? Okay, or you just make it move. Finish your lecture and go away. You don't want to do it. Now, are you understand what this step? Are you understanding now this step? Do you understand this step? Sorry? Yes. Okay. So and so. What is the problem you have? Not sure. You are not sure of the problem, or you are not sure you understand? Okay, let's have this example. But forgive me, it will be profile, because it's difficult to plot 3D example here. So suppose we approximated the subsurface. Suppose it's four layers. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? And now I will draw the voxels. Okay, according to this, we suppose to split each layer with only one voxel in thickness and number of voxels laterally. So from the a priori model, we have here V1, V2, V3, and V4. So far, so good? Okay, so these voxels will assign the value of velocity V1. These voxels will assign velocity V2. And also this V3. And finally, V4. Now we understand? Now we have the a priori model, we obtain velocity with depth. Okay? And now here we have the profile we want to apply tomography for. And we divided the subsurface into voxels or blocks. So we assign for each block the value V1, V1, V1 for belonging to layer 1. V2 is for layer 2, V3 for layer 3, and V4 for layer 4. This is the initial assignment of velocity. These are the values what we are going to use to start the algorithm. The output will be different. Okay? It will differ according to the output of the algorithm, of the tomographic algorithm. Right or wrong? Understand or not? Go further. Okay. So this represent an example of the representation. Here we have the voxels or parallelogram, And also, these points also are the nodes. Nodes. So sometimes we can use representation using both algorithms. Yes, yes, Oi. The point?
The point you mentioned, the shortest line is the node.
As the constant?
No, the node.
The node. Uh-huh. Yes?
So the node is belong to. If let's say the node within these two layers, which one does this belong to?
According to your assumption. Okay? It depends on your assumption. If you choose these nodes to belong to the older or the deeper one, so we will give the values for the deeper velocity. If you use this as representing of the shallower one, you will give the values of the shallower velocity. Okay? And here also, you can see according to data, the distribution of blocks and voxels are not regular, but it's irregular, depending on the data. Now we come to checkerboard test. What is a checkerboard test? Checkerboard sensitivity tests are useful to assess the ability of tomographic inversion to resolve structural details in the earth. Suppose I want to estimate model for function I know its exact value. If I have the exact or true model, at this point, I can estimate the error or misfit. Okay? If you have the true model or exact solution, because exact is true, it's error-free, and then you numerically estimated the function, you can assess, you can measure the misfit or error. Okay? What's the definition of error?
Error.
Yes? Okay, so you have to, you should have reference to estimate the misfit or deviation from this reference. Okay, in our case, we don't have reference. Because if we know the structure of the earth, the interior, the subsurface structure, we wouldn't have applied tomography or made all this complicated algorithm. So we start with a model we made ourselves, and then try to obtain the result of computation, and then compare between the model we know as input and the inferred or estimated model. This is a way, one of two ways to verify the output model. Because in all essence, in all cases, the computer will give you result. But it's up to you to decide whether this result is good or not. So in tomographic inversion, lack of an explicit inverse operator, which means the true model itself and the computation formulation makes it difficult to estimate parameter uncertainties and resolution for the inverted model. The checkerboard test is a useful alternative which gives a general picture of the resolving power of tomographic inversion. It can be applied to any inversion procedure without knowledge of the internal operation, meaning you can apply for any algorithm used in inversion, in seismic or even in other disciplines. This is an example. This one is the input model. These are the checker. It's like a chessboard. Okay. I'm sorry. Okay. So the Godfather told us to start. Okay. Okay. So can we have just 3 minutes to finish? Okay. So here we compare between the result from this. You can see that. Okay. To have the 3 minutes, you have to be quiet. So you can see that the upper part have resolution higher than this part. Okay. So in the final estimation, you will concentrate on this part for model parameters. So the model estimation itself, we have two steps. Sorry. The first one is the ray tracing. And ray tracing is to trace where the ray moved, to estimate lengths and to estimate travel time. And then the iterative technique to minimize difference between observed and travel and the calculated travel time. In ray tracing, we have here the source and here the receiver. We want to trace the trajectory of the ray using this as a Snell law to define this length and this and this until it reaches the second one to estimate the lenses, and from these lenses we can obtain the velocity, the travel time. This is another example of the ray tracing at many points for many source receivers. And here is the complete ray tracing for all reflectors and for all geophones. So from all these rays, we estimate travel time based on the assigned velocities here. First final step in model verification, to verify the model, we have to apply the model several times, to apply the computational several times. If it's stable, we'll end up with the same model or nearly the same model. And sometimes also we insert a small portion or small percentage of noise into the input data and apply the iteration. If the model is stable, we will obtain the same model with small modification. If it's not stable, we'll have totally different model. Thank you. Okay, meet you tomorrow, child. The marks will be available in the evening at the e-learning facilities portal. Okay, thank you.